U.S. President Joe Biden says he will not support an Israeli attack on sites related to Tehran's nuclear program.
Ukrainian forces have withdrawn from the town of Vuhledar after 2.5 years of fighting.
Georgia heads to key election amid divide between pro-Russian government and pro-EU public. President Zurabishvili talks to Euronews about her push to align Georgia with Europe.
U.S. President Joe Biden says he will not support an Israeli attack on sites related to Tehran's nuclear program when asked about Israel's possible response to Iran's missile attack on Tuesday. Biden's comments came after he and fellow G7 leaders, including foreign ministers from France, Germany, Italy, and the UK, spoke by phone on Wednesday to discuss coordinating new sanctions against Iran.
The answer is no. I think there's things we'll be discussing with the Israelis what they're going to do, but they have, all seven of us agree that they have a right to respond, but they should respond in proportion.
Meanwhile, U.S. State Department spokesperson Matthew Miller addressed Israel's move in barring the U.N. Secretary General Antonio Guterres from entering the country, calling the move unproductive. Members of the U.N. Security Council held an emergency meeting on Wednesday to discuss Iran's attack on Israel. Israel's ambassador to the U.N. said that Guterres' latest statement calling for de-escalation in the Middle East conflict is detached from reality. The Secretary General condemned Iran's attack during the meeting, but at the same time urged Israel not to hinder ceasefire efforts in both Lebanon and Gaza.
Kyiv forces have withdrawn from Vuhledar in the Donetsk region, Ukrainian military command confirmed on Wednesday. Having advanced from west, south and northeast, Russian soldiers were geolocated, planting Russian flags and freely operating in various parts of Vuhledar. Vuhledar's strategic importance is in its location. The town sits on higher ground between the two fronts, eastern and southern. To the south, Vuhledar was the last fortified town before the village of Velika Novosilka and the entire southern part of Donetsk region that Ukraine controls. The town is roughly 40 kilometers east of the administrative border with Zaporizhia region. Controlling Vuhledar would also help Russian forces improve their railways logistics, which might help them advance further. 50 kilometers north from Vuhledar is Russia's primary target, the town of Pokrovsk. Although threatening to Pokrovsk 1000 flank, Russian forces would need to maneuver across open terrain to meaningfully support offensive operations southeast of Pokrovsk. The Institute for the Study of War said it is unclear if Russian forces will make rapid gains beyond Vuhledar in the immediate future. Now, advancing across an open field area during the upcoming muddy season would be complicated for Russian forces. It is possible that Ukrainian military command factored the weather aspect in when deciding to withdraw its forces from Vuhledar. And whilst it won't be an issue for Russian forces to take the full control of the town now, the muddy roads and fields will be almost unusable for mechanized assaults should Russian forces decide to advance further. They might decide to wait for the ground to freeze before considering the next steps, which would happen in about a month in southern part of Ukraine's Donetsk region.
The United Nations is warning of a humanitarian catastrophe unfolding in the Middle East following 10 days of strikes on Lebanon. Lebanese are finding themselves displaced and they have been crossing into neighboring war-torn Syria. The United Nations Refugee Agency's representative in Lebanon told Euronews that people might try to reach Europe despite the high costs and risks for those fleeing.
Logistically, from a safety point of view, not easy to go anywhere else but flee within Syria, within Lebanon, or go to Syria, because otherwise the options would be going towards Cyprus and Europe by boats, and that is logistically difficult, less safe, and for many also extremely expensive. I heard quite ridiculous high prices that one now has to pay in order to get onto a boat to Europe.
According to Lebanese authorities, almost 1 million people have been displaced, which is approximately 20% of the country's entire population. Lebanon is also home to 1.5 million Syrian refugees and has a dire political and economic situation. The UN has called for financial support to ensure basic life-sustaining services and infrastructure.
All our programs of UNHCR, the refugee agency, but many other organizations, we all need money. We launched an appeal together with the government earlier this week. 425 million is desperately needed in a range of sectors across agencies.
Last Sunday, the European Commission announced 10 million euros in humanitarian aid. The EU has also repeatedly called for a ceasefire in Gaza and now in Lebanon.
There we have no influence as humanitarians. We can only indicate what the consequences are of decisions not being taken, things not changing. And if that is the case, then we need to all brace ourselves for an increasingly larger, precarious humanitarian catastrophe.
The Israeli military said the ground operation in Lebanon was aimed at destroying infrastructure used by Hezbollah, and it had no plans for a wider operation. But the Iranian missile strike on Israel on Tuesday night leaves the future of the conflict open. Georgia is heading towards a crucial legislative election on October 26. The South Caucasus country is polarized between a pro-Russian government and pro-EU public opinion. Georgia's head of state, Salome Zurabishvili, has proposed what she calls the Georgian Charter, which aims to align the country with the European Union.
En vue des élections, il nous reste un mois, l'Europe ne peut rien faire, sinon confirmer que si les élections sont remportées par les partis pro-européens, si la charte est mise en application très très vite après les élections, dès que le Parlement sera formé, que les premières mesures soient prises, que l'Union européenne dise dès aujourd'hui qu'elle sera prête à mettre en œuvre, elle aussi, à reprendre, je dirais, la conversation là où elle s'est arrêtée.
Georgia's negotiations to join the EU were frozen last June after the ruling party adopted the so-called foreign agents bill. Zurabishvili faces the challenge of coordinating parties that aim to join the EU but have contrasting political ambitions.
Il sera assez difficile d'aller tout de suite, et on n'a pas cette habitude, vers un gouvernement de coalition. Donc moi, ce que je leur propose, c'est de former un gouvernement technique chargé d'accompagner la Géorgie jusqu'à l'ouverture des négociations. Ça sera des questions très techniques à régler. Le programme, il est connu. C'est le programme des mesures qui sont à prendre pour satisfaire aux diverses recommandations européennes.
Meanwhile, caught between Russia and Iran, Georgia finds itself hosting migrants from both nations.
Des migrés iraniens, il n'y a pas de nombre croissant. Il y a eu des périodes où il y en avait beaucoup plus qui étaient attirés par des investissements en Géorgie. Et pour une raison d'ailleurs que je ne connais pas très bien, il y en a beaucoup moins aujourd'hui. Vis-à-vis des Russes qui viennent s'installer, il n'y a pas eu vraiment de conflit. Et cela mériterait sans doute un peu plus de surveillance prudente par les autorités, parce qu'au nombre de ces 60 000, il doit sûrement y avoir des personnes qui servent d'autres intérêts que les nôtres.
This year's COP29 climate change summit is gearing up in Azerbaijan's capital, with governments, businesses, and climate activists meeting to prepare and address the issues of the UN summit in November after another record-breaking summer and autumn of heat waves and devastating storms. Azerbaijan is pushing for a new climate financing goal of the previous Paris climate agreements to get the industrialized countries to pay more.
That is really for us a make or break issue, because without finance, climate finance and new finance, all the entire global climate architecture may not be what we see today. So for us, finance is really what keeps Paris Agreement together.
energy transition is another key aspect of the summit, which is expected to ignite a major debate at the COP29 with a focus on clean energy goals. But the needs for oil and gas continue to be an urgent objective for Europe in its constant quest for energy sources. Azerbaijan's deputy energy minister told Euronews that his country continues to source energy for Europe, and gas exploitation and exports could continue in this sense if requested. A focus of this week is how businesses will be involved in the energy transition. That came with a warning that it would lead to a shift in labor. Some workers would be in demand, such as engineers, while others could be left behind. Indian startup founders said the event is a way for them to find financing for their company that turns metal waste into other products to avoid burning them and releasing carbon emissions.
Networking is very important because we meet diverse people at once, you know. And not only we save time, but we also save our resources by going here and there. We meet diverse people who come from interesting stratas of the society.
Panelists included workers with businesses deep in the fossil fuel industry, such as British Petroleum and the Azerbaijan State Oil Company. Organizers said they wanted to bring a diverse set of people to the table.
Unless we make climate action pay and profitable, probably we are going to be facing a lot of difficulties in terms of fighting and tackling climate crisis.
The Baku Climate Action Week wraps up on Friday with a look at how to equip young people for the green jobs market.